Welcome to the Canadian Anti-Semitism Education Foundation's web talk series, Justice for Jews. Today, our guest is Matan, CEO of Tirtzu, a major Zionist NGO in Israel. I'm Andrea Spindle, Executive Director of CAEF, a registered Canadian charity that is combating anti-Semitism and anti-Zionism and leading the End Jew Hatred movement in Canada. CAEF responds to specific incidents of Jew hatred, provides a weekly bulletin to our subscribers, cooperates on projects with many partners. To continue our work, we need your financial support. So please make a donation by going to our website and clicking on the donate button. That's very simple, www.caef.ca. I would like to acknowledge and thank our co-sponsors today, which include Tirtzu, the International Christian Embassy, Jerusalem, Addis Israel Synagogue, the Lawfare Project, Americans for a Safe Israel, Canadians for Israel's Legal Rights, and End Jew Hatred Canada. Anti-Zionism is not the same as expressing disagreement with the policy of the Israeli government, but is the denial of the Jewish people's national identity and historic right to the land of our ancestors. It is almost always a cover for anti-Semitism, even when expressed by Jews. We are not talking about debates about borders or debates about political views, but about the very denial of history, of law, of facts. How then can academics teaching in Israel deny their own peoplehood and the indigeneity of Jews in Israel? How have non-governmental organizations gained a foothold in Israel, attracting foreign funds and contributing to the divisiveness in the Israeli society? Who are these NGOs and their leaders? You will shortly hear an answer to those questions. It's my pleasure to introduce Matan Peleg. Born and raised in Israel, Matan is a married father of three. He holds a BA in political science and Middle Eastern studies from Haifa University and an MA in conflict resolution from Jerusalem's Hebrew University. Matan previously hosted the radio show Radio Tzion, which focused on Zionist awareness in Israeli society. In 2014, he published his first book, Between Rishikesh and the Temple Mount, and his second book in 2016, The Battle for the Zionist Idea. This webinar is being recorded and will be available on our website and forwarded to all who have registered today. After Matan presents, he will take a few questions, so please use the Q&A function on your Zoom screen, and I'll do my best to get to your questions. Welcome, Matan.
Shalom. Thank you very much for having me. I had some difficulties with my, you know, it's like Murphy's Law. I had some difficulties with my computer, but I hope now everything will be okay. It's amazing that in the minute that you are not ready, it starts to restart, but I hope it will be okay. So as you said, first of all, I really want to thank you all your organization, of course, and all the people that are here, and also our friends from Canadians for Legal Rights, Goldie and Irving, that are very close friends to us, and we're doing things together that I will talk maybe a little bit also about that, but for talking about our subject, about anti-Zionism and anti-Zionism from within, that it's also a fascinating phenomenon, I think, because the anti-Semitism, the obsession of anti-Semitism is very old. I think the obsession to the Jewish people is older, much older than the word anti-Semitism. And, but also auto-antisemitism, all auto-antagonism to the Jewish people, people that are Jews and started to promote ideas against the Jews, also changed with the time. Antisemitism became anti-Zionism, and also auto-antisemitism became sometimes auto-anti-Zionism, auto-Israel. It's like Pinsker said, Judophobia, in his auto-emancipation book that was published a little bit before the Jewish state of Herzl, also talked about this judophobia, this obsession. And no matter what we will talk about now, this is all about this. We are handling and we are facing an ancient phenomena that just changed with the time. So now we'll happy to start the presentation. So about him, Tirtzu, maybe I will talk also later, but let's drop in. First of all, before we sink into Israel, I want to jump to see for a second the world, the place, because a lot of time we're talking about Israel, zoom in and not seeing the general picture. In the general picture, if I'm an alien, and I'm sure you will agree with me, if I'm an alien and I'm looking at Earth, looking at the world, I can think that the world looked like this. How do I know that this is what alien will think if we will look at the world? They will think this is Earth, but there is a huge state in the name of Israel that is bigger than other places. It's because if I'm looking at the United Nations, for example, there is not even one country that is this credit and bashed so much as Israel. Israel, as average, is more than 20 times a year, is condemned by nations in the world. Again, it was anti-Semitism, and after the Jewish country was born, it became anti-Zionism, antagonism to the Jewish state. And we are seeing it very much in the United Nations. If I'm an alien, and I will look and I will listen to things, that conversations that people talk in the United, in the European Union, I will also think the world looked like this. Everything is peaceful, but only one country that is evil and big, and how do I know it? I'll give you three examples. Turkey is occupied North Cyprus. Morocco occupied the Western Sahara. And there are almost 200 places around the world that are under some kind of a conflict, under some kind of an argument, if there belongs to this people or that people. But the European Union only mark goods that are coming from Judea and Samaria and the Golan Heights. They don't care about other places. They care only about the Jewish place, the Jewish country. Also, we can see, of course, the BDS movement, and around the world, we are there are so much places around the world that human rights are so low. I'm talking about the Middle East, North Korea, India, China. There are a lot of places, Russia, with human rights are very low. But from the other side, go to Columbia University, go to Tel Aviv University, and they will always, we will always hear criticize about Israel from anti-Zionist organizations. No matter what happened in the world, the obsession is about the Jewish state. And of course, it's also in the world media. Okay, this is the environment. Those are the waves. This is the pressure that very small Israel is handling every day. Now, let's clean the board and start to talk about the subject that we are now talking, after understanding the big picture, the waves that are around us. What is going on inside? This anti-Zionism, this anti-Semitism, this antagonism to the Jewish people, is also coming within. How? European governments, also by the way, the United Nations, but for a second we will talk about only about the European Union, because it was 28, now it's 25, because Britain is left it, brings millions of euros to organizations, to Israeli organizations who claim that Israel doing war crimes in Gaza. There are a lot of organizations. the situation in Gaza is very complicated. Okay, we did ethnic cleansing of Jews in 2005, tried to make peace, tried to solve the conflict, tried to do something good, but organizations, Israeli organizations who say, no, the situation in Gaza is very simple. We are doing war crimes and this is it. If you simplify the conflict and this is your claim, you will get millions of dollars from the European Union and also from governments that are in the European Union. For example, Germany and Britain and all the other countries give also dozens of millions of dollars to those organizations. In Judea and Samaria, the same. If you say, well, the situation is complicated, the PLO is very corrupted, and they are stealing money from one each other, and they always choose terror and not try to make some kind of arrangement with Israel. If you will say that, you will not get money. But if you are saying that Israel is doing apartheid policy in Judea and Samaria, then you will get millions of dollars, millions of dollars. And with this money, as we all know, they are going with this money back to the European Union, back to the United Nations, calling for international pressure on Israel, try to encourage the foreign governments to force the Israelis to get out of Judea and Samaria, no matter, and to create a new Palestinian country, no matter reality and what is going on in the Middle East. War crimes and apartheid are both crimes against humanity. So that is the reason that I'm coloring them in black. Because when you're saying those claims, you are saying that you don't have a right to exist because you're doing the most awful crimes that humanity can create. The Negev. European Union, foreign governments give money to organizations who claim that we are doing ethnic cleansing to Bedouins in the Negev. You know, the Arab population in the Negev are Bedouins. They used for lots of years, they went from place to place. And now with the time, they stopped to nomad. They started to do villages and they started to settle down. But sometimes, and it's very natural, that the state is coming to those places, those villages, and say, no, you cannot be here or there because we didn't plan it. You must go and build your home in a regular places. In France, by the way, have the same argument with the gypsies. There are a lot of gypsies who moved in Europe with the caravans. And with the time, the caravans stopped. They stopped here, they stopped there. And the French government a lot of time come to the gypsies and say, look, you cannot build a village here and that's it. You must cooperate with the government. You must respect the law. But so the conflict, this argument is something that is familiar around the world. But if you are an Israeli organization, you say, no. The situation with the Bedouins is very simple. We are the Jews, the Israelis, they're doing ethnic cleansing to Palestinian Arabs, which they don't because the Bedouins are not Palestinians. They hate the Palestinians. But anyway, if this is their claim, they will get millions of dollars from governments. And then this claim that is ridiculous and no one takes seriously become very loud and very strong around the world and also in Israel. So it's considered very radical and very lunatic claim to say that we are doing apartheid in Judea and Samaria or ethnic cleansing to Bedouins in the Negev. But because of the money, because of their funding, and also because of the hug that they get from governments, from foreign governments, they have much more impact around the world. Also, I can give you some few examples more before we will continue. The Golan Heights, there are organizations who claim that, you know, Israel tried to find oil in the Golan Heights. An Adala organization, for example, Adala is this one, not a few months ago, went to the United Nations and said that we are stealing oil from the occupied Golan that belongs to the Syrian nation, which there is not a Syrian nation because they're just killing one each other and they're completely different groups in what was called Syria 10 years ago, maybe. But still, it doesn't interfere with their ridiculous claim. And again, stealing oil from the Syrian people, stealing water from Judea and Samaria, from the Jordan Valley, doing ethnic cleansing in the Negev, doing war crimes in Gaza. This propaganda is very strong, is very loud. They are promoting those ideas inside Israel, and they are promoting those ideas as Israelis in the international community. And also, for example, even the Hamas in 2014, after the Protective Edge operation, it was the Chavez report that investigated if the IDF did war crimes in Gaza. And Hamas was very angry about the United Nations that they didn't say that we did war crimes because a footnote, they said, but breaking the silence are saying that the IDF did war crimes. So these anti-Zionist voices that are not authentic, because the vast majority in Israel are not support those ideas. They think those are lies. They think it's lunatic to say that we are doing war crimes or apartheid or stealing oil from the Golan Heights or doing ethnic cleansing from other places. Those voices that are the small minority in Israel becomes so loud and strong that and all our enemies are using those claims. Like this, in short, Israel is getting bashed from within in every meter. For when we looked about on the big picture, for example, let's take the BDS movement. The BDS movement is trying to convince all the world that Israel doesn't have right to exist. Israeli organizations cannot convince the Israelis that we don't have right to exist. And also, if Israelis will go to the United Nations and say that them themselves don't have a right to exist, it will sound strange, it will sound weird. So what they are doing, they splitted to slices the land of Israel and delegitimize it in different areas. This one is apartheid. This one is war crimes. This is ethnic cleansing. This is racism. And like this, they are trying to promote those ideas from within. Now, by the way, those are the numbers. But the problem is a little bit more complicated, because when we are talking only about NGOs, non-governmental organizations, when we are talking about propaganda organizations, someone can say, well, who cares? They're just talking, blah, 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 who cares? They can, so maybe the ICC in Hague will convince, but maybe not. But the problem is the propaganda organizations are not staying in propaganda. What we are doing also in Tirtzu, we are showing that the leaders of those organizations are professors in Israeli academia. We are showing that the European governments also sponsored courses in Israeli universities to volunteer and to participate and to work with those NGOs, meaning that Israeli student a lot of time can because it doesn't have a choice, use to work with those organizations and also get their knowledge and their perspective. So the leaders of those organizations, they are not objective. They indoctrinate the Israelis about how Israel doesn't have a right to exist, doing war crimes since 48 and so on. But also lots of the courses are sponsored by foreign governments and led by those organizations. We are seeing it also in our cultural elite. A lot of people in our cultural elite are supporting those organizations, and we are seeing it very much in the media, but also in courts. There are organizations, Israeli organizations, who defend terrorists in court, who are going to court against the settlements in Judea and Samaria, the residents in Judea and Samaria, the residents in the Negev. All the legal, the lawfare, all the attacking from within Israel, from courts, are coming from foreign money, foreign governmental money. I just want to remind you that the United States almost went back to the Cold War with Russia because they blamed them for funding some posts on Facebook to influence the election. In Israel, those foreign governments invest millions of dollars in propaganda organizations that try to change us from within, and for everyone, it looks normal. It is not normal, and it is very important to stop it. When we are seeing this phenomena in the academia, one of the problems is that the academia, as everybody knows, creates the new generation, the next generation of teachers, the next generation of judges, the next generation of parliament members. This is what academia is doing. And when the anti-Zionism is the dominant voice in the Israeli academia, and students in Israel don't know how to justify why Israel have a right to exist as a Jewish state, what are the justification by the international law, for example, San Remo, to the existence of Israel, when they don't know it or know very little, then we are creating a next generation of ignorance. And this is what they are trying to do. The problem with this elite is they create a politically correctness, a state of mind in Israel that is like, people are maybe for the right, if you're looking at the majority, but from the other side, they feel not very comfortable. Not very comfortable as a soldier in Gaza, maybe we are doing war crimes. Not very comfortable in the Negev, maybe we are doing ethnic cleansing there. Not very comfortable in Judea and Samaria. Maybe the best is to give it and make peace with someone. The Israeli society will not survive without a strong belief in the Zionist idea, in the Zionist values. And this is what those organizations are trying to take from us. And they are doing it, again, not only in their campaigns, but in the academia, in the cultural industry, in the media, and in courts. Basically, this is the biggest challenge that Im Tirtzu is facing, because what we are seeing, for example, now we are going to election. In the election, we are the people. We want to choose our leadership, and we want the leadership to govern. From the other side, when we are seeing that our voice in the election not really matter, because no matter what, our prime minister and our government cannot rule because of the pressure, because of the international pressure, and because of those NGOs, okay, this is like a bypass of democracy. A small elite, small radical movements force us to a way of life that we don't want. And they're trying to do it again in the academia and in every in place, of course, also with the in courts. So and by the way, what is really hypocrisy is that I just read a report that the European Union is very angry because now they revealed that Russia is funding NGOs in Europe that try to change the ideas in Europe about the approach of the Europeans about the occupation of Crimea that Russia occupied. So when the propaganda organizations are working in Europe, they don't like it. But when they're doing it to us, that is okay. What Tirtzu is trying to do is to push back this foreign governmental involvement in our reality. So we have branches in more than 20 campuses in Israel, 7 universities and 13 colleges. We are doing seminars for Zionist thought. That by the way, the J-Post, the Jerusalem Post said that gave us like said that our seminars is the most popular seminar in the Israeli academia. So because we are providing Zionist knowledge to students because they don't go there. Now every project of Tirtzu, we have measures of success. Our seminars, we don't need measures of success because we see so much students who come to listen, who come to learn. Like this, we understand the need of this of those seminars, the need of this information. Because I'm Israeli, I'm a student, and every time when I hear only anti-Zionist knowledge in classrooms, I know that something is wrong. Then they come to our classrooms. And we are doing tours now because of the COVID-19, we have less, but basically every year we're taking hundreds of Israeli, especially students to Hebron and to Jerusalem. We are doing a lot of work against anarchists who harass our soldiers on the ground. If we will have time, I will show maybe some examples, some movies like this. And because some of the BDS activists around the world and also anarchists in Israel, they come to harass our soldiers in Judea, in our borders. They're coming with their mobiles and then the soldiers cannot tell them to go because they're like reporters. So they're harassing our soldiers. So it's very problematic. And we, of course, we're doing a lot of campaigns, a lot of legal fight to try to stop them. And also we're working a lot in the Knesset because we are trying to also change the laws. The involvement of the European governments in our Knesset is very strong. And this is, by the way, the reason that until now, we don't have any law that is very strict against those NGOs, like the FARA, the foreign agent law in the United States. In Israel, it is very hard to promote those kind of laws because the foreign governments are very, very involved. And also our government is a little bit afraid of it. Last thing that I want to say is that we are calling it, maybe you know, us and the legal the Canadians for Legal Rights Forum, the group of Goldie and Irving that we work with, we are promoting together in Israel the San Remo, I like to call it the San Remo approach. It's like the parallel of Jabotinsky, the iron Kira Brazil, the iron steel, the wall of the iron wall, sorry, the iron wall, if you know what I mean. We are saying that we have the right of all Israel, also what was became Jordan with the time. We have the right for all Israel. This is our approach. We are not apologizing about it, and we are not we don't want to compromise about it. Now there is reality, so we understand that sometimes you cannot have what you want, but basically we don't need to apologize. We need to be very strong. We need to demand our rights. We need to demand our independency. We don't think the foreign governments need to take our liberty, our independence. This is not the colonialist time is done, is over. The British mandate is not here anymore. So we must be strong with our demands and our approach. This is, by the way, these photos are from the San Remo, last San Remo, a day that we did. We did a lot of, we had a lot of cooperations from ministers, a lot of from Knesset members, and also Uzi Dayan, the Knesset member Uzi Dayan is now also promoting the law that in Israel we will celebrate the San Remo. That was, by the way, Goldie's idea, that we will mention the San Remo day every year in Israel as a holiday, because this is the San Remo approach. Those are some of our achievements with the time, but I think I will maybe open for questions, because I also, a lot of time I had a problem with the Wi-Fi, so I'm not sure everything went smooth. So let's open for questions.
Okay. Thank you, Matan. I have some questions that have been sent in. I'm going to start with a question and a comment. First of all, from Goldie, who sends her warmest regards and is really thrilled that you're here today. So thank you again for doing this. We're very pleased to be aware and supportive of the relationship that you have with Canadians for Israel's Legal Rights. You mentioned trying to regulate or respond to the NGOs. Has there been any legislation, specifically legislation proposed to regulate or prohibit NGOs from registering and functioning in Israel if they are denying Zionism, if they are perceived to be anti-Israel or pro-BDS?
So there is a law in Israel against calling to boycott against BDS, but because of our legal justice system, it's very complicated to use it. But basically, BDS, hardcore BDS NGOs, they're not very much in Israel, but basically most of the things that they want to do, they do. And also call for boycott outside of Israel. And then they say, we didn't pass the law. The laws that we succeed to promote in this issue are most of them about transparency. It was also a war in Israel. The European Union criticized us very much, and but we succeed to promote a lot of transparency laws and others. For example, organizations who call not to serve the army, we made a law that they cannot go inside schools. It was also very important for us, those kinds of laws.
Do you have a legislative agenda that you could share with us, that we could publicize in terms of the next steps in this battle with the NGOs?
We believe that the most important thing to do is to tax them. We want to tax those organizations. We think this is the best thing to do, because we can, I'm looking at Israeli society, those organizations, also, I'm not sure that we want to take those NGOs out of law, okay? If people have those kind of thoughts, they can have those kind of thoughts. If they think, someone have the right to think whatever he wants. There are people who believe in aliens, and there are people who think that Israeli soldiers doing war crimes. Who cares? The problem is in their power, in their strength, if those radicals have so much power, so much money, then it's become a problem. Because then there is no equation here. The radicals in every side don't need to be so strong. No matter who are the radicals, the majority are always moderate people. So we think that the most important thing in the next government, we are holding this for almost 3 years because there is no government in Israel. But we say that the most important thing is to tax them. If the German government wants to give $10 million to Bezalem, we need to tax them in 50%. This money needs to come to us, to the Israeli people.
So it's basically what we would say here is taking away their charitable status. They wouldn't be tax exempt anymore, right?
Yes, full start.
What about at the universities? Are there specific universities or colleges, not just individual professors, but actual institutions that are pro-BDS that promote that? Or is it individual, just happens to be individual radicals at each college?
Good question. Because every president of university will answer, no, those are radicals here and there. The last president of Ben Gurion University, Professor Rivka Karmi, she said that in Be'er Sheva University, there are around 10% of BDS supporters around it. And I said, this is a lot. I don't understand why she said it's nothing. It means that one of 10 professors is like bashing Israel.
It's true. What about funds coming to these NGOs from North America? Do you see the link? What we've become aware of is that there are pro-Palestinian student organizations sending money to Palestinian activist NGOs, such as Samadan, which was just labeled a terrorist organization in Israel, but university students in Kingston at Queen's University were very recently, in January, raising money for that organization. Has there been communication between Tirtzu and or the Israeli government with governments in other countries like Canada saying you should not be supporting that? This is a terrorist organization. They should be listed as terrorists here as well.
You know that we published the foreign affairs minister in Israel published a report. I can also send it to you after the conversation. It's in English, and you can provide it to all the people that are online. And we showed I'm saying we because some of them the information came from us, but the report shows that there are a lot of BDS organizations who have connections, direct connections with terror groups, with Hamas and with others. And of course, this is very problematic thing. Until now, we saw very little change. Also in the European Union and also in the United Nations, very small changes. I don't understand why, because as you said, those organizations are considered to be terror organizations also in Canada, also in Europe. So this hand is against, but this hand give money to those NGOs. This is a very problematic issue.
Well, maybe I could mention, it may be these two reports. I had intended to mention them and you could comment. I listened to a webinar the other day from the Ministry of Strategic Affairs and the report, there are two reports, one called Behind the Mask and the other Terrorists in Suits. And I suspect Tirtzu contributed a lot to that. Can you say a little bit more about that report? What I understand is it exposes BDS as a terror movement.
It shows this, the phenomena is not that the BDS is a terror a group. There are terrorists who are active in those NGOs. Okay, even a few months ago in one of the terror attacks in Judea and Samaria, the terrorist was an accountant in one of the NGOs that are mentioned in this report. It was Adamir, if I'm not mistaken. This is really a radical BDS movement organization. We have direct connections with those, and this is not something new. Okay, and also there are foundations in Ramallah that gets foreign money, foreign European money, but and they give the money to Breaking the Silence and B'Tselem, and so yeah, the connections are very, very close.
You haven't named specific organizations. I don't know if you're comfortable to do that, but NGO Monitor has published a report that does suggest organizations like the New Israel Fund put money into these Israeli-based organizations that are working against Israel. Do you have a list of such organizations as well?
Yes. By the way, the NGO Monitor is a very good organization, and I highly recommend to go to their website. We also sometimes using their materials because they are very active in investigate this subject. Sometimes we also compare about the differences with the money because not always we are using the same sources. Most of the time we are getting almost the same amounts, but their work is very important. I think one of the differences between NGO Monitor in Israel and Im Tirtzu is that we believe more about legislation in Israel about it. And NGO Monitor, which I respect their approach, they believe more about trying to convince the European governments in not support this. I see it like it's just complete one each other. I respect their thing. We are less optimistic about the European approach to Israel. So we are using our energy to different places, but they are doing amazing work.
No, I agree. And I thank you for that, because my next question was really going to be, how do you track the funding? It sounds, you said there's different ways. How do you track the money come in? You gave us a number of 150 billion or something that has come in to these NGOs. How do you track this money? Do they report it? Transparent? Are they even telling you and filing reports?
Yes. One of the things that because of the transparency law that now in Israel, it is a little bit more easy to collect the information about their budget. Also, every quarter, if you are an organization who get money from foreign governments, every quarter you're supposed to show it. By the way, our research division always go about every organization like this and say, you didn't give your report in the right time. And we are going this also to the Knesset and try to force the government to do something about it, because some of those organizations, they don't care about the law because they are not afraid. This is a important point. I just want to remind, if someone doesn't remember, the last foreign minister of Germany, his name was Sigmar Gabriel. It's in my board for a different reason. Sigmar Gabriel, when he came to Israel in a formalic visit, he said, I'm going to visit B'Tselem and Breaking the Silence. And Prime Minister Netanyahu said, if you're going to meet them before you are coming to see me, I don't want to see you. Because this is a propaganda NGO, and a foreign minister is supposed to go and talk with the parallel guy, not with NGOs that they're active in. And the foreign minister of Germany said, I prefer to meet Breaking the Silence and not you. And it wasn't a meeting. He met only Breaking the Silence.
And he did come?
And he met the radical NGOs. When something like this happened, this changed a lot in the equation, because the power that you feel when a foreign minister from a strong country like Germany prefer to come and visit you than the prime minister, this has ripple effects everywhere. This is one of the reasons that no one wants to touch Breaking the Silence in Israel. There are, even now, when we are talking, as we speak, there are soldiers that cooperate with also very Zionist organization. The name is Ad Kan, maybe you heard about it. Together, they went to sue Breaking the Silence, because Breaking the Silence used those testimonies to blame those soldiers. So the soldiers are angry, but the justice system in Israel, they will never touch it. They will never touch breaking the silence because it's like an embassy, a foreign embassy.
Does it not endanger the lives of soldiers?
Depends who you ask. Some of those soldiers are very angry because they say, look, now, because of those testimonies that no one knows who gave them, and they were investigated, by the way, the IDF took so seriously the stories of breaking the silence, so they really investigate, and they saw that there is no truth in it. But those stories continue to hug and to European Union, so to the story, but the soldiers are afraid. They say, look, what will happen now? Because of the ICC issue, I will be arrested in England. Now, because of the COVID-19, we will never go there. But basically, so yes, the soldiers are angry.
Yes, I could see why they would be very nervous, and it seems so unjust. How do you deal with, I know you've done educational projects, and in fact, you did a major one with Canadians for Israel's legal rights. Can you talk a little bit about your work in educating young people in Israel, and are there lessons for us here? If in fact, young people are so persuaded by these counterproductive anti-Zionist organizations?
I think, first of all, you know, Passover is very soon, right? Pesach is very soon. And this is very important because in Pesach, we say, "V'higadeta lebincha," right? Give the story to your son. It is very important in Passover that every parent will know the story of Exodus, we know the story of Yetziat Mitzrayim, that he will have the knowledge to tell the story to their son. Like this, you know the story and your son will know the story. Zionism don't have a vehigadeta. Zionism, we still didn't understand how important it is that the parent will know the story of Zionism and how important it is that he will know how to tell it to the kids. This is the reason that it is so important that we will educate Israelis, but also Jews around the world to know about Zionism, to tell the story about Zionism, to tell the story about the historical great miracle of the Jews who came, you know, to history, to life again as a country, as a nation. And what we're doing in our educational programs is exactly this. We are educating the students and also sometimes kids to know more about Jerusalem, to know more about Hebron, to know more about their lives. And because a lot of people think that Zionism is a modern phenomena, modern invention. But how can it be a modern invention if we had a state, independent state, maybe in a different way, but what is it? The first temple, the second temple. What was in Hanukkah? What was the uprising against the Greeks when they came here? It was all about Jews want to be independent in their homeland. So this nationality approach, national approach, patriotic approach is something that is ancient. But when we don't speak about it, we don't know about it, we will split. This is the people who in Pesach, people understood it, this mechanism. This is what we are trying to do.
I think you're pointing out that Jewish education today is not Zionist education. There's a question here that I think is very intriguing, and I don't know if you can deal with the psychological aspects, but Jess Sands writes that she wants to understand the psychology behind anti-Israel Israelis and Jews. Major General Matty Peleg was her thesis advisor at Harvard. He was left-wing but wasn't anti-Israel in the 70s, but his son and daughter, it states here, have an insane pathological hatred of Israel. And the question I was going to ask, which is built on that, is how do you explain anti-Zionism and is that not Jew hatred, even if it's Jews?
Yeah, so I cannot explain it. I think, Andrea, that also you cannot explain it, this phenomena. The thing is that we don't need to, as we see it, we don't need to explain it. We just need to work with it, to present our answer to it. Because as we said in our conversation before, anti-Semitism, the obsession to discredit the Jews is more ancient than the word anti-Semitism. But also Jews who comes against the Jews, it's a very ancient phenomenon. This is something that we know. And look, there were in the beginning in the 20s and in the 30s, there were Jews in Germany who blamed the Jews in the same level. Yeah. And so this masochism, this problem will be always. I think what we need to do against it is always to be very strong, to have this San Remo approach, to believe in our cause and not to apologize, and also but also to educate our kids, to educate our people. Maybe I asked also, by the way, my father one time, I asked him why the educational system in Israel don't put a lot of weight about teaching the kids why we are here. So we said, look, we came from the Holocaust, and we are the second generation of parents that came from the Holocaust. For us, it was obvious. So, but now it's less, and it is very important to remind the people.
So I have two more questions here. What I read maybe last year in one of your bulletins, is Sim Tirtzu was actually putting a list together of professors that promote BDS. I don't know, do you maintain that? Do you update it? You were heavily criticized. I don't know if you were sued about it, but you were exposing these folks. What's occurred since then? And is that an available list?
Yes. Yeah, so I will be happy to send you the link. And if you can also send it to everyone once. We have a website that we always update about professors Israeli professors who bash Israel around the world. And when we got a lot of backfire about it in the media, we said, this is very hypocrite thing to say that what we are doing is wrong, because we are doing you a favor. If you are a professor and you say that Israel are, we're doing war crimes, instead of saying it also in Berkeley, California, now the Israelis also know that this is what you're saying.
And the Guardian will know who to call
if they want it. This is another thing about the money. Oh, sorry.
Is there a list?
What?
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. I was still talking. I apologize. I just think we should add to your list. We should have North American professors added to the list.
Yeah, and also it is important for people in North America, for example, to know when they hear about an Israeli professor who come to visit in this website, then they can know who they are. Because sometimes naturally, when they are Israelis, we think they are maybe pro-Israel, and it's not. And again, this is the problem, because you can be a regular professor to teach in the Hebrew university. No one will care about you. You're a regular person. But when you start to bash Israel, you become a celebrity. And it's like, and it encourages you more and more, because when you are starting to blame Israel from within and to call to boycott Israel, then you get invited in BDS events around the world. You become a very important man. So if you are hating, if you are working against the Jews, there are a lot of people who really want to pay on it.
Well, the last question is about, you have an election coming up. What's happening in the Knesset in terms of the work that you do? Do you have support within the Knesset, or do you have people opposing the work that you're doing? What's the current situation, and what do you expect?
You mean on general or now after this election?
After the election.
We believe that after this, no matter what, after the election, our friends will still be Knesset members. We have friends in both ways, because don't forget, now it's not about right and left. It's like there is a very big group that is against Netanyahu and a very big group that is for Netanyahu. So there is a mix between left and right here. A lot of people that are rightist are now against Netanyahu. But so in those parties also, we have a lot of very good friends. Im Tirtzu will continue to have our friends. But again, a lot of times, I can even give you I have a minute for a short story. I will tell you something, but I'm sure you will never believe, but I will challenge you. One time we had a very big meeting with some Knesset members about the importance of, we did like a presentation about the importance of tax those organizations. And we said, this is governmental money. This is anti-democratic thing to do. Let's tax the money. And some of them said, look, the legal advisor of the Knesset meet a lot of European Parliament members all the time. And they don't like those laws. And I said, who cares? Who cares? We're an independent country. Why we need to be afraid of those people? And they said, well, this is the situation. So even if we have very good connections, and even if, you know, the politicians have their heart in a good place, the challenges are very big. Look at Khan el-Ahmar, the illegal village that is on the road between the Jordan Valley and Jerusalem. It's completely illegal, and we're supposed to take it out. But because of the European governmental pressure, the Israel government cannot do anything about it. So at the end of the day, we are strong. We are a strong country, successful country, but in the end of the day, we are small. There are 7 million, 8 million Jews in Israel, okay? This is half than the people of Cairo. All Israel can go to a few neighborhoods in Cairo. We are small, so we have a lot of challenges. We will be okay.
Well, Matan, I want to, we need to draw to a close. It's fascinating talking with you. Thank you so much for the presentation today and for taking the time. We will send this to everybody that's been listening today and all those who have been registered, plus the 4,000 people on our major email list, and our sponsors will also distribute it. So hopefully we'll get the message out to a lot more people. Thank you and stay well. And thank you everyone for joining us today, and take care.
Bye. Thank you very much. Toda.